incredible information. Yeah. Great stories. Window in on that amazing Los Angeles scene of the 1960s and 70s. And this great quote. Many of the guys immediately before us were pretty much jazz players who could rock, whereas we came at it from being rock and roll guys who could play everything else.
Yeah.
And the we in that sentence, of course, is the band Toto, who are performing here this evening, 11:15 at the Nile stage.
Woo!
And the idea in that quote that I love is that there are many paths to reach musical nirvana. That perfect song, that perfect solo, and in the end, style, genre, doesn't matter. So for the next 45 minutes, we'll be talking with one of the founding members of Toto, one of the most prolific LA session men.
Hey, man. You might want to put some high end on this, man. It's a little dull. It's a little dull like me.
Ladies and gentlemen, Steve Lukather.
Oh, please. Thank you. You don't need to do that. I'm really surprised so many people showed up. Thank you very much.
Should we start with just a little bit of music?
I don't know what we're doing, so I just showed up here. Anything can happen. I could say anything, so if you're offended, you better leave now.
Yeah. No. Track number one, if you would.
I've heard this in 100 years. When I did that, I was just a kid.
1977 was the year.
Yeah, I was 19 years old at that
point. I was not aware of that.
Yeah, you were still a teenager. I haven't heard that in like, you know, 40 some odd years. Boss Gags.
My
first big time gig.
A Clue is the name of the tune, and that's from 1977, his 1977 album.
That's a happy
two
memory.
Two Steps Down. And, do you wonder,
what is this? This Is Your Life? If you're going to play me a song?
No.
Well,
no, I will not do that to you. That was the
there's
one.
There's nobody going to come out of here. Are my ex-wives coming out of here? Where's my fucking money?
Right.
No, I'm just teasing. I'm friends with my ex-wives.
And half of the Wrecking Crew, you know.
No, I digest. I'm a wise guy, so be aware of that.
But that solo, what's very important to you?
Well, it was the first solo I did on a big time record, you know. And I was like, Boz gave me a shot. I had just joined this band, you know, with Jeff Porcaro and Steve Porcaro, and basically the beginnings of our band. We came after that summer tour, we were working on our first album.
Right. So Boz.
Boz was a big catalyst, you know. I will always be in debt to him for that. He was really sweet to me. Because back then there wasn't a lot of teenage kids on the road playing with a big artist. And now there's a fetus that plays like Stevie Ray Vaughan, so it's really, the competition's way deeper than it used to be.
Are you feeling that heat?
No, man, I'm an old guy. I'm past it. It's like I survived for, what is it, like 44 years? Almost.
So that 19-year-old birth of, you know, that baptism of fire.
Well, the thing was, back then, that was a 24-track tape. You had one track, and you didn't get to do it again. So you had to play it all first time right.
Right.
So there was pressure with that. Now it's like, take 100 tracks, take your time. It's a different mindset now.
We're in the Pro Tools age.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think Dean Park said it best. He said, before Pro Tools, there were pros.
Oh, yeah.
Nice.
That was Dean Park's, but I'm just quoting it.
Well, you know, you had to hit it. You had to hit it. And there's another term in the Gospel according to Luke that I love, and it's zero take.
Oh, that was just a lucky one. I thought it was David Crosby put me up to that.
Okay.
I was walking out the door, and he goes, I was with Danny Korchmar and Sklar. We were going to go hang out at dinner or something like that. As we'd been working all day long, Cross goes, hey man, can you do a solo on this tune? And I looked at Cooch and I went, yeah man, let's do this. He goes, you want to hear it? I said, no man, what key is it in? He goes, E minor. I said, okay, roll the tune. How many bars? 8 bars. Okay, let's try it. Let's see what happens. I don't want to hear it. Just let me know. And there was some change. It wasn't like giant steps or nothing like that. It was, but I didn't know what we were going to play. And I went for it and got it. And he said, that's great.
Without even hearing the track.
I never heard the track. He didn't play the song for me.
So you just
gave me 2 bars. 1, 2, 3, 4, 2, 2, 3. And then play. It was like a 16-bar solo. And I just went for it. And he liked it. Kept it. The only other one I did like that was Running with the Night with Lionel Richie. I was just, that was my warm-up take. I go, play me the tune. I just started playing all over the thing. And I go, yeah, I think I got this. Let's do one. He goes, you just did. It's over. And I said, come on, man. I played too much shit on this. I played way over. He goes, no. It's great. Love it. Get lucky once in a while. That doesn't happen every time.
That's amazing. But growing up in that atmosphere in Los Angeles, I wish there was a way we could convey. I mean, and your book really does do this job.
Well, thanks. I got a documentary I'm going to start working on with Nigel Cole, who did Springsteen's, and Sony's funding it. And I'm gonna, it's going to be kind of about all that, and then all the players.
Right.
I want to get all the players that didn't get, that don't get all the love. You know what I mean? There's a lot of brilliant guys, like Dean Parks is one of them. But all my guys, all the guys I grew up with, you know, Michael Landau, I've known since we were 12 years old, best buddies. A lot of the guys that aren't famous that should be.
Right. That Los Angeles scene just sounds incredible. And to be born into it, and to be growing up with the teachers and the other.
Well,
the
I was geographically placed well. There's no kidding. Thanks to Mom and Dad, you know. But I went to school and I met Steve Picaro. And the, actually, I met Mike. I mean, we had bands ever since I was 9 years old. And then, but then when I hit high school, Mike and I met Steve Picaro, and then we met the whole family, and we realized Jeff Picaro was in Steely Dan when we were in high school, so we realized the bar was that high. And so we all studied our asses off with the dream of becoming a studio player, having our own band. Never really thought we'd get it all, so it was a very, very, it's a gift from God. You know, there's a lot of, there's probably some guy in Wyoming that plays the shit out of the guitar that won't get a shot. There's a lot of, there's so much more talent now at the high level at a young age. So I wouldn't want to be a kid starting out right now. That'd be really hard.
Well, I think that speaks to the whole idea of community and the idea of growing up with that kind of support. And
well, yeah, I mean, there was nothing else to do. There was no gadgets. There was, you know, there was no, music was everything. And it was audio. It wasn't visual as well. So we'd listen, get a record and we'd listen to it. And we would be quiet and we would play it and discuss it and then start trying to learn it. It was all we did was music. We used to cut school to play music. And we studied music, so it was, we all studied together, inspired each other and pushed each other. It just sort of like went like that. We got an opportunity. See, it's luck to get in the door, but to get asked back, you have to have some skill. You know, you prove yourself. And if you fuck up, they don't call you back. And bad news travels real fast.
One chance.
Well, I mean, you know, pretty much. You had to be good. Okay, kid, we hired you. What do you got?
Yeah.
And if you freeze up, I saw some really great players freeze up. They saw the red light.
Oh, really?
Guys that you just go, burning guys. That just could, you know, you get a chart that says B minor, A, G, and that's it. And they count off the song. There's no demos. There's nothing. So immediately you'd have to grab a part, you know, especially if I was playing with another guitar player like Lee Ritenour or Jay Graydon or somebody like that. You know, and Ray Parker Jr., you know, those are the guys that I worked with the most. And Dean Parks. Those were the guys I sat next to mostly and learned from. You know, there was definitely a pecking order of things. You know. I was the new kid, so I still to this day, if I was ever to do a session with any of those guys, I would sit in the second chair out of respect.
You know. You know, the model in your day that you were shooting for was Steely Dan.
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, we love that. I love that music. Some people don't, you know. I was never a punk musically. I was a punk mentally, but I was not. You know, that was a whole other, that was a whole other thing, man. Pretty funny.
But that whole Steely Dan aesthetic of
we were really inspired by that.
Yeah.
I mean, probably because Jeff Picaro was playing in that. But I love the music to this day. It's still Desert Island music to me.
Right.
Just how meticulous the production and the playing. And though back then, it was real takes. It wasn't like, oh, we could fix this and move this and tune this and all that. So those were, you know, I heard the stories of how painful those sessions were. Like, take 148, you know what I mean? It's not right yet. Fire the drummer, get another bass player.
Right.
So we're going, shit, that's a pressure right there.
Bring in Wayne Shorter.
Wayne, man. I got to stand next to him once. That was humbling.
Yeah.
One of my favorites.
You know, we're going to share the conversation with you guys. So very soon, if you have any questions. How many guitar players are here, by the way?
Hey, guys.
Yeah, hey. the microphone will be passed around, and we'll ask for some questions from you guys to please join the conversation. You know, there's a reason for this T-shirt I'm wearing.
What?
For the T-shirt that I'm wearing.
Well, it was Miles, yeah.
And that was
a wild experience, man.
Yeah.
Miles
and because I haven't read the whole story, how did it happen? How did he meet you guys?
Because I know getting to work with Miles was because Miles was doing that pop record with Tommy La Puma, and he was cutting Human Nature, which was Steve Picaro's song that we did on the Thriller record. So Steve was the only guy that could do that intro with all of his weird, wild analog synthesizers. So he ended up at David Page's house, and David and I had written the song. There was like Sketches of Spain kind of a thing. We thought, Jesus, what if he heard it? We can get him to play it. And we're doing this record Fahrenheit back in 1986. And Dave had two pianos in his living room. I played one, and he played one. And Miles, after he had met us, we were hanging out for a little bit. Felt comfortable to ask him. He liked the tune, and he said he'd do it for us. We're like, come on. And then he went out and did one take, and that was it. It was like, wow. And then he called me after the record came out. He wanted me to join his band. I'm going, are you serious, man? We were leaving the next day to come here, as a matter of fact, to start a three-month tour. 2 months here and then a month in the States, and I couldn't go. I said, geez, how do you say no to that? But then I said to him, well, you could fire me the next day. You know what I mean? I said, I got to stay with my band, my band of brothers. But it was a great honor to be even considered, really.
So this is 1986.
I'm not worthy of that shit, you know?
All right. That's how
that
I
wasn't
feel
for me, I know, but it was funny.
You know, we actually have it queued up.
Oh, you're kidding, really?
Yeah, Don't Stop Me Now from Fahrenheit.
Yeah, I haven't heard this stuff in a long time. That's Dave Sandberg.